This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, let's start. Hope it's audible to everyone. Okay, today, before we discuss database programming, let us discuss one more concept. After that, I'll go for database programming. Today, I'll start with what modularization techniques. Modularization techniques. Okay, so after completing the modulation techniques, I will go for database programming. Right, so modulation techniques means, what is the meaning of modularization is? It is a process of breaking the program into what individual blocks. Okay, so modulation is nothing but what? It's a process of breaking the program. Okay, process of breaking the program into what? Into smaller blocks. Okay, process of breaking the program into smaller blocks. Right. So what is a block here? A block is nothing but what? It's a set of what? Statements. A block is nothing but what? A set of statements. It's a set of statements which is defined only once. Okay, which is defined only once and can be called any number of times. And can be called any number of times. Okay, that is the meaning of what block. Okay, so in ABAP we can achieve this modulation in different ways by using subroutines. Okay, by using include programs. Okay, by using function modules. Okay, by using methods. That's it. Subroutines, include programs, function modules, methods, and by using what? Macros. So this macros, no, basically it is used in mainly in what? HR ABAP. Okay. So I repeat this once again. Modulation is nothing but what? It is the process of breaking the program into what? Smaller blocks. A block is nothing but what? It's a collection of statements which is defined only once and can any number of what times. That is the meaning of what a block. Right, so we can there are different types of modulation techniques in ABAP. We have subroutines, include programs, function modules, methods, macros. Okay, all this comes under what? Modulation technique. So what is the advantage of modularization? By using modularization, okay, we can increase the what? Reusability. Okay, advantages of what? Modularization. Okay, this increases what? Reusability. Increases reusability. Okay, and next point is maintenance cost is what? Decreased. Maintenance cost is what? Decreased. Maintenance cost is decreased and increases what? Readability of the program. Increases the readability. Okay, and another point is efficient control on what? Program flow. Okay, efficient control on what? Program flow. These are the advantages of what? Modularization. Make clear? So you'll understand all this one when you go to the practical part. So far what you are doing is we are writing the entire logic in a what? In the program. Okay, so instead of writing the logic step by step, we have to break that particular program into what? Smaller blocks. So into smaller blocks. A block is nothing but what? A set of statements which is defined only once and can be called what any number of what times and can be called any number of times. Okay, so let's see first what subroutines. Okay, so what is a subroutine means? A subroutine is nothing but what? It's a collection of statements. A subroutine is nothing but a collection of statements which is defined only once and can be called any number of times. I repeat once again, a subroutine is nothing but what? Collection of statements which is defined only once and can be called what? Any number of times. So let's see an example on this. Type of program as usual, what executable program? I'll save it in the local object. Just try to understand this. So suppose I'll just use some write statements. As of now, let me use some write statements. So I'll say write. I'll just give some statements here. Write Coreb app. Opsab app. Cause apps. Then I'll say something. Write welcome. Right, so my program contains some write statements. Okay, it contains some write statements. Okay, when I execute this, syntax check, no errors. When I activate and execute, then I got the result. Hello, Coreb app, Opsab app, Cross apps, welcome, so on, so. Okay, so if you observe the result here, there are some statements in the program which are available at what multiple points in the program. Okay, so if you see this Coreb app, Opsab app, and Cross apps, we are having this here. The same statements again we are having here. Again, we are having the same statements like this. Okay, so there are some set of statements which are repeated at multiple places in the program. Okay, so these repeated statements, instead of writing it again and again, we have to put it inside what? A block. We have to enclose it inside a block and we need to access that block wherever required. So what I'll do now, instead of writing the statements again and again, okay, I need to enclose it inside a subroutine. Okay, subroutine. So what is this subroutine means? You can assume subroutine is similar to a function in your C language. What is the programming style in C language? We'll write the program in the form of what? Functions. In the form of functions. Okay, so we'll define the function only once and we can call the function any number of times. Okay, similarly here also a subroutine has to be defined only once and can be called any number of times. Okay, so these subroutines we have to define it at the end of the program. So subroutine is associated with two parts. One is definition of the subroutine. Another is what? Calling of the subroutine. Understood? What are the statements which has to be executed at multiple places? We have to what? Define that statements inside a subroutine. And wherever you need to access that statement, we need to call the subroutine. Okay? So what are the statements which are repeating at these three statements? So I need to define it. So how do you define a function in C language? If you take our C language, how do you define a function? Something like this. Void XYZ. You'll open something like this and here you'll open this floor brackets and you'll close the power brackets. Okay, so this is nothing but what a function definition. In case of C language, this is nothing but what a function definition. Okay, and how do you call that function? I can call that function any number of times. So simply you'll say x, y, z. Okay, like this. This is the way to call the function in C language or what, C++. So we are defining it only once, but we are calling it what, n number of times. Similarly in ABAP also, okay, in ABAP also, similar to function, we have what, subroutine. So how do you call a subroutine here? Here we use the keyword what, perform. Perform, what is the subroutine name? Assume x, y, z. Okay, this is nothing but what, calling the subroutine. And here also, what, perform what, x, y, z. So we are calling the subroutine. How to define the subroutine? You will say form xyz and form xyz, and then here you will say what, end form. Okay, so this is a way. Okay, this is a way to define your subroutine. Here in C, C++, we'll open this flower brackets and close the flower bracket. This indicates beginning and end of what function. Here in ABAP, form, end form in nothing but what, subroutine definition. Okay. So we have to define the subroutine, and we can call that subroutine any number of times by using what, perform keyword. So what is our requirement here? There are some statements which are repeated at multiple places in the program. So these repeated statements, okay, you have to keep it inside what, subroutine. And where do we define the subroutines? At the end of the program. So here I'll say form. You can give any subroutine name. Let me give the subroutine name as what, sub1. Any name you can give. Form sub1 and what, end form. Form sub1, end form. So what are the statements which are repeating this one in a, so instead of writing them again and again, I'll put them inside a subroutine definition. Okay, so I'm enclosing that inside a subroutine definition. This is nothing but called as what, subroutine definition. Form, end form is called a subroutine definition, right? So let me remove these things here. The repeated statements, I'm keeping that inside a subroutine. Done. So what I am doing here is, I'm just defining the subroutine. I'm just defining the subroutine, but I'm not calling the subroutine. So when I execute my program, what is the result I'll get? I'll get what, hello, welcome, hi, and what, bye. So let me execute this. Done. When I say F8, I got the result as what, hello, welcome, hi, and what, bye. Understood. So what is happening is, even though you have defined the subroutine, we are not calling the subroutine. We are not calling the subroutine. That's why, okay, the subroutine is not executed. So in order to execute that subroutine, we need to call the subroutine. How do you call the subroutine? We have to use a keyword called as perform. So I'll say perform. I'll say sub2. So when I say perform sub2, what happens? It will check for a subroutine definition with the name what, sub2. We don't have any subroutine definition with the name sub2. So when I do syntax check, yes, I got an error. The form sub2 does not exist. The form sub2 does not exist. One second, please. Let me just ping to others. Most of them are absent today. Just hold on, please. Just 2 minutes. Okay, done. So I'm getting an error here. What is the error I'm getting? The form sub2 does not exist, but there is a form with a similar name, what, sub1. Okay, so what is the subroutine name here? Sub1. So I need to call that sub1 only. So I'll say sub1. Okay, so what is the advantage of subroutine? I can call it what? Any number of times. So I'll say perform sub one. Here also I'll say perform sub one. So when I do syntax check, no errors. Done. So I'm defining it only once, but I'm calling it what? More than once. That is the advantage of what? Subroutine. The repeated statements, you have to enclose it inside a block and you can call it any number of times. So let me execute this. When I execute, when I say F8, yes, I got the same result. So what is the advantage of the previous from the previous approach? Instead of writing these statements again and again, we are enclosing that repeated statements as part of a block definition, as part of subroutine definition. Excuse me, please. Hello. Yes, I'll call back. Right. So the repeated statements you have to enclose inside a what block definition, and you can call it what any number of times. So when I execute, I got the result as what so and so. Let me try to debug. Okay. So I'm interested to debug from the beginning of the program. So after activating the program, I'll put the cursor on this first line. I'll put the breakpoint. I'll set the breakpoint. Done. Let me say F8. I'm going to say F8. Whenever the breakpoint is encountered, it takes the control to a debugging mode. So this is a new debugger. Let me switch to the old debugger. Okay, I'll go to the old debugger. Okay, so somewhere here. Okay, switch to what? Classic debugger. In the go to menu, navigate to what? Switch to classic debugger. Yeah, I'm in the classic debugger now. So you can see now, it is about to execute the first statement. How do we execute one statement at a time? F5. So I'll say F5, then it got executed. So when I click on this, yes, I got what? Hello. I got hello, done. Next, I'm calling the subroutine, perform sub one. So whenever we call the subroutine, what happens? Control jumps to what? Subroutine definition. So when I say F5, control jumps to the definition. Let me say F5 now. Yes, control is jumping to what? Subroutine. Definition means we are shifting the control from one part of the program to what? Another part of the program. We are shifting the control from one part of the program to another part of the program. So let me say F5 here. Done. So since the execution of the subroutine is finished, control is coming out of the block. So if you see the result here, I got up to this one. Okay, control is coming out of the subroutine now. Where it goes now? To the next statement from where the subroutine was called. To the next statement from where the subroutine was called. So here if you see, when I say F5, yes, it is going to the next statement after the subroutine call. I'll say F5, I got what? Welcome. Right, I got welcome. Done. Next, I'll say F5. Again, what happens? You're calling the subroutine. Control jumps to what? Subroutine definition. So when I say F5, yes, control is jumping to the subroutine definition. Okay, it is jumping to the subroutine definition. I'll say F5, done. It has executed. See the result so far. I got the execution done. Now again, the control is shifting, coming out of the subroutine. I'll say F5. Again, it will print that right I statement. Yes, I got I. Okay, control will go there. Again, we are calling the subroutine. Control jumps to definition. It will execute that. Done. Next statement is what? The last result by. I'll say F8. Yes, I got the result. Okay, so this is nothing but called as internal subroutine. Internal subroutine means which is defined as well as called from the same program. We have something called as external subroutine. As the name itself suggests, external subroutine means which is defined in other programs and called from another program. So as of now, we are focusing only on internal subroutine. It is a subroutine which is defined as well as called from the same program. So any questions in this part, please ask me. So the developer has to take the decision when to go for subroutines. If you feel that the same set of statements has to be executed at multiple places in the program, then instead of writing those statements again and again, we'll enclose them as part of the subroutine definition. Wherever you want to execute that statement, we can just call the subroutine by using what? Perform statement. Any questions? Okay. Done. So a subroutine can be defined either with parameter or without parameter. Understood? A subroutine can be defined either with parameter or without parameter. So as of now, I have defined the subroutine without what? Parameters. I can create what? With parameters. How do you create with parameters here? Somewhere here I'll say, let me just separate by using new line. Okay, try to understand. I'll declare some two variables. Generally, you'll declare the variables at the beginning of the program. So I'll say data, or let me use parameter statement. Parameters. I'll take some two variables. Okay, parameter variable generally will start with what? P underscore x type I. Let me do some default value. Default, I'll give 20. I'll take another parameter variable, P underscore y type I. I'll say default what? 10. Okay, default 10. Understood? So I can declare them by using parameters, or I can declare them by using what? Data. Data keyword will not generate any selection screen. Okay, so I'll go for data. Otherwise, data V underscore x type I. Okay, for data, I cannot use default keyword. I have to use what? Value keyword, right? Value 10. And here I'll say what? Value 20 and value 10. Done. So what I'll do now, I'll call the subroutine perform. Let me give the subroutine name as sub2. What is my requirement now? I want to pass these two parameters, x and what? Y. X is what kind of parameter? Integer. Y is also what kind of parameter? Integer. Understood? So whenever we are passing standard data types as parameters, I repeat, whenever we are passing standard data types as parameters, okay, we have to use a keyword called as using keyword. Okay, so I'll use a keyword called as using. What is the variable name? V underscore x and what? V underscore y. So what I'm doing here, I'm trying to call a subroutine. What is the name of the subroutine? Sub2. How many parameters I'm passing? Two parameters. One is V underscore x, another is what? V underscore y. What is the keyword I'm using here? Using keyword. When we have to use the using keyword? Whenever you are dealing with standard data types as parameters of a subroutine, we have to use the keyword what? Using. When I say standard data type, integer, character, string, date, pack, time, all this comes under what? Standard data types, built-in data types given by SAP. Now when I do syntax check, I'll get an error because we are calling the subroutine, but we have not defined the subroutine. So when I do syntax check, yes, I got an error. The form sub2 does not exist. Okay, so I need to define the subroutine. Where do we define the subroutine? At the end. Okay, so when I say at the end, I can define it here, or I can define it here. Doesn't matter, but make sure that all the subroutines are at the end of the program. Okay, so somewhere here, I'll try to define form sub2 using. Okay, how many parameters I'm passing? Two parameters. These parameters, we call it as what? Actual parameters. The parameters which we specify at the time of calling, we call it as what? Actual parameters. Okay, now I'll say form sub2, and I'll close this form by using what? End form. So what is happening is we are defining the subroutine, but we are not mentioning the parameters. Okay, the signature is what? Different. While calling the subroutine, we are passing two actual parameters, but we are not mentioning any formal parameters. So when I do syntax check, yes, I got an error. See the error here? Different number of parameters in form and what? Perform. Routine sub2. Number of formal parameters is 0. Number of actual parameters is what? 2. It is saying that you are passing two actual parameters, but you are not receiving it in what? Formal parameters. So what I have to do, I need to receive that particular formal parameters. I have to receive those values in what formal parameter. So here also I have to start using, right? So if I give like this, this is giving me what? Syntax error, because we are not mentioning the formal parameter list. So let me say what forms up to using what is the actual parameter name? V underscore x and what? V underscore y. So these two are called as what? Formal parameters. The parameters which you mentioned as part of definition, we call it as formal parameters. You can observe here the formal parameter names and actual parameters are name or what? Same. It can be same or different. So when I do syntax check now, I don't have any errors. So what is the understanding? This V underscore x value will come and sit in this one, and y value will come and sit inside V underscore y. So I can do like this, right? I can do like this. Okay, let me see or here. What I can do, I can give different formal parameter names. Let me give k1 and what k2. This is also fine. Means the formal parameter names can be same as that of actual parameters, or it can be what? Different. So what happened now? X value will come and sit in k1 and y value will come and sit inside what? k2. So what is my requirement now? I want to do some calculation. I want to do some addition and display that particular addition. Okay. So I require one variable now. I require one variable for storing the result. So you need to decide whether you have to declare that variable globally or locally. Okay. Globally means what? These variables are at the word global. Any variable you should declare outside the subroutines, they are what? Global. They can be accessed throughout the program. If you want that variable to be used only within a block, you have to declare it locally. It means you have to declare that inside a subroutine. So what is my requirement here? I want to do the addition. I want to print it there only. I'm not going to use that variable outside the subroutine. So instead of declaring it globally, I'll declare it what locally. So I'll say inside my subroutine, I'll say data. Let me declare one variable LV underscore Z type what I. So generally local variable name will start with what LV. You can give any name. I can give simply V underscore Z only. But just to differentiate the global variable and local variable, I am starting with what? LVA, which to indicate that as a local variable. So this is nothing but what? Local variable. What is the lifetime of this variable? It is within the block. I can access that variable only within that block. So I'll say LV underscore Z is equal to K1 plus what? K2. Then I'll print it right. Sum is what? LV underscore Z. So let me execute this, save, check, no, that's done. When I execute, yes, I got the result. What sum is what? 30. Let me quickly debug this. I'll put the breakpoint somewhere here. I'm putting the breakpoint somewhere here. So when I say F8, yeah, it has opened the new debugger. Let me switch to the old debugger, navigate to switch to classic debugger, done. So if you see V underscore X, observe here, what is the value? 20. V underscore Y is what? 10. V underscore X is 20 and V underscore Y is 10. Okay, done. Now, what are the formal parameters I declared K1 and K2? Na? So observe here, if I say K1, I'm getting this in red color, means the variable is not yet recognized. Okay, these actual parameters are declared globally. They are recognized throughout the program. But the K1 and K2, they are specified as part of the subroutine. So they are also local. That's why they are not yet recognized. K2 is also in red color. What is the other variable? Let me scroll down. What is the other variable declared? LV underscore Z. That is also declared where? Within the subroutine. So it is also not recognized. It is also in what? Red color. It is not yet recognized. Understood? They are recognized only within the block. Now what you are doing here, we are calling the subroutine by passing two parameters x and y. So the control jumps to subroutine definition. This x and y value will be copied to what? K1 and K2. So the moment the control will jump to subroutine definition, these variables are recognized, identified. When I say F5, done. So you can see now, they are not in red color now, it is recognized. K1 is 20, means x is copied to K1. And y is copied to k2, and if you further scroll down, LV underscore Z also is recognized, but default integer contains what? 0, right? So I'll say f5, done. LV underscore Z is what? 30. f5, done. I got the result. What is the result I got here? What sum is what? 30. The control is coming out of the subroutine. When I say F5, right? So you can see once a control comes out of the subroutine, again, the formal parameters and the local variables are what? Destroyed. They are recognized only within the block. That's it, over. When I say F8, I got the result. Any questions in this part, please ask me. Once again, let me switch on the laptop charging. Done. Okay, so now I'll say, let me just say clear. Okay, after the subroutine call, I'll say clear v underscore x and what v underscore y. I'm just clearing the values. Okay, and let me assign new values. Right, so or else I'll say perform, just try to understand, perform sub 2 using, earlier we passed what variables. Now I can directly pass the values also. Doesn't matter. Understood? 30 and 40. So overall, how many parameters you are passing? Two parameters. What kind of parameters are integers? That's why use what? Using keyword. So what happens now? Again, 30 will come and sit in K1 and 40 will come and sit in what? K2. Again, we are doing the calculation. So when I execute, when I say F8, then I got the result of sum is what? 70. Okay. Now let me clear the values. I'll assign new values, v underscore x equal to 45, v underscore y is equal to something, 67. Let me call it once again. So what I'm trying to show is, I can call the subroutine what? Any number of times. And I say fit. Yes, I got the result, 112. Okay, so this is a way to pass standard data types as what? Parameters. So these two actual parameters values will go and sit in what? Formal parameters. We are performing some calculation and the calculated value is stored inside what? A local variable. We are doing some calculation, we are printing there only. The moment the control comes out of this subroutine, the formal parameters and the local variables will be destroyed. Okay, so in this case I am not returning any values from the subroutine, just I am passing the values to the parameters, but I am not returning any value from the subroutines. So if you take our C++ Java environment, if you want to return anything from a function, we use a keyword called as return keyword. Okay, and there in C++ Java we can return only one value. But whereas in ABAP, we can return any number of values. Okay, So let me show you how to return the values from a subroutine. So just observe here. Let me declare some two variables, data, something. V underscore R1 type I. I'll declare another variable, V underscore R2 type what I. Done. Now I'll call the subroutine, perform. I'll give the subroutine name as sub3 using what? Let me pass same v underscore. What is the last value of v underscore x and v underscore y? 45 and what? 67. Okay, or else 45 and 37. Okay, perform sub3 v underscore x and v underscore y. I want to return two values from the subroutine. So if you are returning, you have to receive it here. How do you receive it here? You'll say changing v underscore r1 and v underscore what? r2. Okay, changing v underscore r1 and v underscore r2. Done. So I need to define the subroutine. I need to define the subroutine. Let me define. So it's a form. What is subroutine name? Sub3. Overall, how many actual parameters are there? 4 actual parameters. V underscore X, V underscore Y, V underscore R1, V underscore R2. Okay. So here, how do you define it? Same signature you are defined. Form sub3 using, let me say something M1 and what M2, or I can say K1 and what K2. No problem. Then here also I have to say changing. I'll say M1 and what M2. So what is the understanding here? How do we understand this? This V underscore X will come and sit in K1. V underscore Y will come and sit in K2. And V underscore R1 will come and sit in M1. And V underscore R2 will come and sit in what? M2. Now what I'll do? M1 is equal to K1 plus what? K2. Okay. And M2 is equal to what? K1 minus K2. Okay. So I want to return this value. So in case of C language or C++ or Java, we use what return keyword, return what M1, and there we can return only one value. But whereas here, this M1 and M2 is understood as what returning parameters. It is understood as returning parameters because they're declared as what changing. Changing means they are going to be returned. So this M1 and M2 will be returned, which are received inside what V underscore R1 and V underscore R2. So initially when I declare them, what is the default values of these two? Zeros. Na? We are passing zeros. V underscore R1 is 0, V underscore R2 is 0. To come and sit in M1 and M2, we are storing some calculated result in the changing parameter, nothing but returning parameter. They are returned back to the same variables. Now I will say write. I will say something just for your understanding. I will say return values from subroutine, return values from subroutine what? Sub3. Okay, return values from subroutine sub3. I'll say write. Just I'll give a meaningful message. Sum is V underscore R1, and then I'll say what difference is V underscore R2. Okay, so when I execute this, no errors, done. So what is the understanding here? To return the value from the subroutine, we have to use what keyword? Changing keyword. Okay. So when I say FH, done. So return values from the subroutine sub3. Sum is what? 82. Difference is what? 8. Okay. Sum is 82. And difference is what? 8. Done. So I got the result. Let me debug. I'll debug. Just observe. I'll put the breakpoint. I'll say FH. Right, it is switching to the new debugger screen. Let me navigate to classic debugger, old debugger. We'll see the new debugger also. I'll use it after a few days. So if you see V underscore X, how much? 45. V underscore Y is how much? 37. V underscore R1 is what? 0. And V underscore R2 is what? 0. So we are, overall, we are passing what? 4 parameters. So why we are declaring this as changing means nothing but they are received. Okay, my subroutine is going to return that return values. The return values will come and sit in these variables V underscore R1 and V underscore R2. So when I say FI, okay, so when I say FI, see where the control jumps. Control jumping the subroutine. So it is received in what? K1. K1 is what? 45. K2 is what? 37. And M1 is by default 0. M2 is what? 0. Because V underscore R1 is 0, V underscore R2 is also what? 0. Done. We are doing the calculation. I'll say FI. Yeah, M1 is what? 82. What is the corresponding changing variable for this? If you see here, the corresponding variable is V underscore R1. What is that? 82, na? Okay, the sum is stored inside variable M1. That M1 corresponding variable is what? V underscore R1. So V underscore R1 is also what? 82. And if you observe, V underscore R2 at this stage is 0. And M2 is also at this stage what? 0. Okay, so when I do the difference here, the result will stored in M2. Okay, and since M1 and M2 are changing parameters, what are the corresponding variables here? V underscore R1 and V underscore R2. So when I say FI, so I can see M2 is 8, and even V underscore R2 is also what? 8. So they are written back to what? Those changing parameters. So the understanding from this program is, how do you return the values from a subroutine? By considering what parameters? Changing parameters. How many values we can return means any number of values. Whereas in case of C, C++, or Java, a function can return only one value, and that is done by using what? Return keyword. Here I can return any number of values. The number of return values depends upon what number of changing parameters. Depends on number of changing parameters. Any questions, please ask me. Okay. Yeah, any questions, Nilima, Latika, Manika, Jason, Chinna, Sayed, Vamshi, Partha? Right, so if there are no questions, fine. Done. So what we understood so far is how to define the subroutine, how to call the subroutine. We have defined some subroutine with parameters and without parameters. And we understood that we have to use the using keyword. We have to use the using keyword, okay, to pass what? Standard data types have got parameters. And we understood the changing keyword. It is used for returning the values from the subroutine. And whenever we define the subroutine, the number of formal parameters depends upon what number of actual parameters. What do you mean by actual parameters? The parameters which we specify at the time of calling. And formal parameter means the parameters which we specify at the time of definition. Okay, done. Now let us understand the difference between pass by value and pass by reference. Pass by value and pass by reference. So let me do it in the same program. New line, done. Just try to understand. Okay, I'll clear the values of v underscore x and v underscore y. We can pass the parameters to subroutine in two ways. One is pass by value and pass by reference. Okay, so let me say v underscore x is equal to 10. Okay, and v underscore y is equal to something what? 20. V underscore x is 10 and v underscore x is what? 20. Let me try to print the values of v underscore x. So I'll say, I'll just give some text kind of thing. Pass by reference, done. Here I'll say right, v underscore x and v underscore y, okay, before calling subroutine. V underscore x and v underscore y before calling what? Subroutine. I'll print the values of what? V underscore x and v underscore y. So obviously, what are the current values of x and y? 10 and what? 20. So when I execute this, I'm going to save it. Done. So see this. V underscore x is 10 and V underscore y is what? 20. This is known to us. Now what I'll do is I'll call the subroutine now. Perform. I'll give the subroutine name as sub 4, anything. Let me pass this x and y. X and y are what? Integers now. How do you pass standard data types as parameters using keyword? Using V underscore x and what? V underscore y. So I'm passing two parameters. I need to define the subroutine. So somewhere at the end, I'll say form sub 4 using, let me take k1 and what? k2. Done. End form. Okay. So by default, parameters are passed by reference. So let us understand the difference between pass by reference and pass by value. So let me put it here. This is pass by reference. And this is pass by what? Value. Okay, pass by reference and pass by value. Done. So I declared what two variables here. What are the two variables I declared? V underscore x and V underscore y. What are the current values here? 10 and what? 20. 10 and 20. So here V underscore x is 10 and V underscore y is what? 20. So here I'll say v underscore x is so and so, and then v underscore y. V underscore x value is how much? 10, and v underscore y value is what? 20. Okay, assume that the address location of v underscore x is 100. For example, the address location of v underscore y is 200. Okay. Okay, done. Okay, x is 10 and y is what? 20. Okay, what is the memory location here? 100 and what? 200. What I am doing here? Okay, I printed the values of what? X and y. So on the output, write statement will print the output on the output screen. What are the current values of x and y? Obviously 10 and what? 20. So this is my output screen. I am printing the x value and y value. What is the current value of x? 10. Current value of y is 20. This is the result I'll get so far. Now we are passing those two parameters. We are passing those two variables as parameters to my subroutine. So I'm passing v underscore x and v underscore y. They are received in the formal parameters what? K1 and what? K2. So K1 and K2. So these are my formal parameters, K1 and K2. This is K1 and this is K2. Okay, so the understanding is by default, parameters are passed by reference. By default, the parameters are passed by reference, means the addresses of actual parameters are copied to what? Formal parameters. I repeat, in passed by reference, the addresses of actual parameters are copied to formal parameters, means formal parameter will point to what? Actual parameters. So what is the understanding is, what is the address location of this actual parameters x and y? 100 and 200. So you have to understand that K1 will contain what? 100 and K2 will contain what? 200. This is the default behavior. Means K1 is pointing to what? X. K1 is pointing to X. Okay. And K2 is pointing to what? Y. K1 is pointing to X and K2 is pointing to what? Y. Because what is having inside K1 and K2? Addresses. Means formal parameters will point to what? Actual parameters. Okay, done. Now what I'll do inside my subroutine, I'll declare one local variable, something, let me declare K3, data K3 type I. So this is a local variable. Now anything you declare inside a block, inside a subroutine, nothing but what? Local variables. So assume that this is my local variable K3. Okay, this is K3. And what is the default value for integer? Zero. So K3 as of now what? Zero. So what I'll do inside my subroutine is, I'll try to swap the values. So I'll say K3 is equal to K1, and inside this K1 I'll store K2, and inside this K2 I'll store what? K3. So I'm swapping the values. I'm swapping the values. So just try to understand, when the moment you call the subroutine, the moment you call the subroutine, control comes to what? Subroutine definition. X value is copied to K1, Y value is copied to K2. Actually, value is not copied. You have to understand that addresses are copied. So the address of X and Y is what? 100 and 200. They're copied to what? K1 and K2. Done. Now what I'll do, I'm assigning K1 to what? K3. I'm assigning K1 to K3. What is there in K1? 100. 100 is not the value, no. 100 is 100. 100 is the address. What is the value stored at address 100? This 10 will be assigned to what? K3. So K1 value, I'm assigning it to what? K3. So K3 will contain what now? 10. Actually, K1 is having what? 100. What is the value stored at 10? That 10 is assigned to what? K3. Done. Then K2 should be assigned to what? K1. K2 is again having what? 200. What is the value at address 200? 20, na? This 20. This 20 should be stored inside what? K1. 20 should be stored inside what? K1. So K1 is again pointing to this one. So what happens now? K1 is not disturbed. The corresponding actual parameter will disturb. So what will be there inside this? 20. So I'm trying to change the K1 value, but it is changing what? The corresponding actual parameter. Then K3 value should be assigned to K2. What is there in K3? 10. 10 is a value only, na? Should be assigned to K2. Means K2 is pointing to Y. Na? So what happens here? This 20 will be changed to what? What is the value of K3? 10? Na? None. So you are trying to swap. You are trying to interchange the formal parameters. But it's not actually swapping the formal parameters. It is swapping the actual parameters. Done. So this is the swapping logic I wrote inside my subroutine. Done. Now, after executing the subroutine, control comes to the next statement. Now let me print x and y value again. So x and y after calling what? Subroutine. What are the current values of x and y? 20 and 10. Before calling it was 10 and 20. After calling it was what? 20 and what? 10. So what you have to understand is, by default parameters are passed by reference, in the sense the addresses and actual parameters will be assigned to what? Formal parameters. In the sense, formal parameters will point to what? Actual parameters. So any changes you try to make to the formal parameters will actually reflect what? Corresponding actual parameters. So when I execute, see the result now. How much I got? 10, 20, and then what? 20, 10. Both the times I am printing x and y only. But before calling the subroutine, the actual values are 10 and 20. After calling the subroutine, the values got interchanged. So I got what? 20 and what? 10. This is nothing but pass by reference. So how do we understand the pass by reference? By default, parameters are passed by what? Reference. Means the addresses of actual parameters are copied to what? Formal parameters. Means the formal parameters are going to point to what? Actual parameters. So any changes you try to make to formal parameters will actually reflect what? Corresponding actual parameters. Any questions, please ask me. Let me quickly show you pass by value. Another 5 minutes, just rolled up. So here, where is that? Let me say U line. And I'll clear the values of V underscore X and V underscore Y again. I'm clearing V underscore X and V underscore Y. V underscore X again, I'll set it to 10. V underscore Y again, I'll set it to 20. I'll print the values of X and Y again. Okay, so for your understanding, I'll give the right statement. Pass by what? Value. Right, so what are the current values of X and Y? 10 and 20. Na? So let me execute this. Yeah, just scroll down. Current values of X and Y is what? 10 and what? 20. Pass by value. Okay, now I want to call a subroutine. I want to pass the variables by value, parameters by value. So I'll say perform. Let me give the subroutine name as subfi, any name, using what is the keyword? V underscore X and what? V underscore Y. So the way we call is same. The way we call pass by reference, pass by value is same, but the change will come in the definition. So here what I'll do, just see the change here. I'll define the subroutine subfi. Okay, form subfi. The only change you have to do is, but if you leave it like this, again it becomes pass by reference. But I want to pass by value. So at the time of specifying the formal parameters, you have to use the keyword what? Value. Value of k1 and what? Value of what? K2. Value of k1 and value of k2. So what is the meaning here again? Okay. So let me put it here. So you are declaring two actual parameters, v underscore x and v underscore y. What are the current values of this v underscore x and this is v underscore y? V underscore x is 10, V underscore y is what? 20. Assume the address of x is 100, the address of y is what? 200. Then you are calling the subroutine by passing these two parameters. Then I declare two formal parameters. Assume this is k1 and what? K2. This is k1 and this is k2. So now what you are doing here, at the time of specifying the formal parameters, you are saying value, means we are telling SAP, don't receive the address, receive the value of what? Actual parameters. So what are the values of actual parameters? 10 and 20. Na? So those 10 will be assigned to K1 and 20 will be assigned to what? K2. Means K1 is not pointing to X now. K2 is not pointing to Y now, because we are receiving what? Values, not the reference, not the address. Then I declare another variable K3. So let me declare that K3 here. So this is K3. So initially in the output, what I got when I print X and Y value, X is initially 10 and Y is initially 20. Done. Then I declare another variable k3. By default, it is what? 0, na? Done 0. Now, we are assigning k1 to what? K3. What is there in k1? 10 only. Na? K1 is not pointing to anything. So this 10 will be assigned to what? K3. So k3 becomes how much? 10 here. K3 becomes 10. Done. Next, what you are doing? You are assigning k2 to what? K1. You are assigning k2 to k1. K2 is what? 20. K2 is not pointing to anything. So this 20 is assigned to k1. Na? K1 is not pointing to anything. So directly k1 will be changed here. Am I clear? In the earlier case, you change k1, it is changing the x value. Then k3 is assigned to what? K2. What is there in k3? 10. Na? 10 is assigned to what? K2. Again, k2 is not pointing to anything. So how much is the value of k2? 10. Okay, done. So my subroutine definition execution is finished. Control comes to the next statement after the subroutine call. Na? So let me print x and y once again after calling the subroutine. Okay, so for your understanding, I'll say v underscore x and v underscore y. What is this? After calling subroutine. After calling subroutine also, the value remains what? 10 and 20. So in both the cases, before calling and after calling, it is what? 10 and 20 only. No change to what? Actual parameters. So when I execute, then so if you scroll down here, see. Yes, 10, 20 and what? 10, 20. Understood? This is the concept of pass by value. So in pass by value, what is the concept? The values of actual parameters are copied to what? Formal parameters. So any changes that you make to the formal parameter will not disturb, will not change the corresponding actual parameters. Whenever you want the automatic reflection, you'll go for what? Pass by reference. So how do you pass parameters by value at the time of definition? We have to use the keyword value so that we are telling SAP, don't receive the address, receive the value, so that there is no link between formal parameters and what? Actual parameters. So when there is no link, when you change the formal parameters, do not change the actual parameters. This is the concept of pass by value and what? Pass by reference. Any questions, please ask. So I'll stop for today. We'll continue again on Monday. Next class will be again on Monday. Monday we'll see how to pass internal tables as parameters to what? Subroutines. Okay, and how to define external subroutines, all those things. So once I complete this modulation technique, then we can go for what? The database programming and other things. Then any questions for today? So I'll wind off. I'll send the recordings of yesterday's and today by probably by end of today so that you can practice. Start practicing if you have not started. While listening, it looks simple. Okay, but start practicing. We'll again have the next Coreweb class on what? Monday. Okay. Shalom.